There's nothing like the fellowship of those who love the Lord. So welcome to family. There's always room for more. When I count my blessings, it's easy to see my brothers and sisters that mean so much to me. Kept me in their prayers, and the countless ways they've always shown me that they care. And I know they'll still walk with me no matter what's ahead. Yeah, so much more than just their words, their lives have always said. Welcome to the family, you can feel it. Years. There's nothing like the fellowship of those who love the Lord. So welcome to the family. Oh, welcome to the family. You can feel at home here. There's a lot of love that goes beyond these years. There's nothing like the fellowship of those who love the Lord. So welcome to the family. Oh, welcome to the family.
Look to the Lamb of God, for He alone is able to save you. Look to the Lamb of God. When Satan tempts and doubts and fears assail, look to the Lamb of God. You in His strength shall over all prevail. Look to the Lamb of God. Look to the Lamb of God. Look to the Lamb of God. For He alone is able to save you. Look to the Lamb of God. Fear not when shadows on your pathway fall. Look to the Lamb of God. To endure sorrow, Christ is all in all. Look to the Lamb of God. Look to the Lamb of God. Look to the Lamb of God. For He alone is able to save you. Look to the Lamb of God. You be free from the burden of sin. There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you or evil a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood. Would you be free from your passion and pride? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Come for a cleansing to Calvary's tide. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you do service for Jesus your King? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you live daily His praises to sing? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to Thee. How great Thou art, how great Thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, as the snow. But I know a man who can. Some call him Savior, the Redeemer of all men. I call him Jesus, for he's my dearest friend.
You're standing on the solid rock.
Through my disappointments, strife and discontentment, I cast my every care on the Lord. No matter what obsession, pain or deep depression, I'm standing on the solid rock.
I'm standing on the rock,
on the rock of ages. Savior day by day, and close is our relation, firm is its foundation, so on the solid rock I'll stay.
I'm standing on the rock,
on the rock of ages, safe from every storm, all the storm that rages, rich in love and rich, not from Satan's wages. I'm standing on the solid rock. This last verse. When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we've no less days to sing God's praise than when we've
trusting my Lord, and he gives a song. Though the storm clouds darken the sky or the heavenly trail, I just keep trusting my Lord. He will never fail. He's a faithful friend, such a faithful friend. I can count on him.
Since you talked with the Lord and told him your heart's hidden secrets, how long since you prayed? How long since you stayed on your knees till the light shone through? Since your mind felt at ease, how long since your heart knew no burden? Can you call him your friend? How long has it been since you knew that he cared for you? Since you knelt by your bed and prayed to the Lord up in heaven, how long since you knew that he'd answer you and would keep you? Since you woke with the dawn and felt that the day's worth the living, can you call him your friend? How long has it been since you knew?
Wants us to have assurance of the victory. And Joshua did exactly what he was supposed to do, take it to the Lord in prayer. We ought to improve our prayer life. We need to get into our Bibles more and see what God wants to say to us. Talk to him. He will, in fact, give us assurance of what he wants us to do. And so God says, I'm just going to assure you. I'm going to give it to you right now. And so I love the promises in the Bible. The Bible says in Philippians 1:6, being confident of this very thing, that he which hath begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. God is working in all of us. If you're a child of God, you are under construction, if I might use that term. God is doing a work in your life. And he has a plan for your life and my life. And he is, and Paul says, being confident of this. We can be confident. We can have assurance of what? That God has started a good work in you and he will complete it. Now, that's God at work, and that's exactly what we want to be going on in our lives. Now, how do I receive assurance from God? I receive it from his word. Aren't you glad for the word of God? Aren't you glad you can go to God's word and read the promises of God and know that God means exactly what he says? I thank God for the Bible. It's the only thing that we have stable in this life in which we live. Everything else is changing, but the word of God is forever settled in heaven. It will always be exactly what it says it is right now. You can't change it. You can try to change it. You can change the words. You can do everything else. But I'm saying to you, God's word is forever settled. He doesn't change. The word of God doesn't change. And because of that, you and I can have absolute confidence and assurance in the promises of Almighty God. Now, when God told Joshua, Joshua, you're going to win the battle. Do you think he should have said, I wonder if God really meant that? I don't know. There's a lot of people. There's five armies out there against our one army. He could have doubted, but why should he? Because God is God, and God always keeps his promise. It's wonderful to be a Christian. I'm so glad that I am. Notice who makes the promise, being confident of this thing, that he, which hath begun a good work. Who's he? Well, this is the Lord God Almighty and his son, Jesus Christ. God's working on us to make sure that we can be the victorious person that he expects us to be. Who's he? He's the Lamb that was slain before the foundation of the world. He's the Lord of lords, the King of kings. He's the Lord strong and mighty. He's the Lord mighty in battle. He's the root out of dry ground. He's the Lamb that taketh away the sin of the world. He's my strong tower. He's the rock of my salvation. He's my deliverer. He's my soon coming king. That's who makes the promise. Amen? We can have confidence in such an individual. And what's he doing? It says he's begun a good work in you. What's the good work that he's doing? He's preparing us for heaven. He does this by forgiving us of our sins. If you're a child of God, you've had your sins forgiven. It requires a repentance. You have to come before God and you have to say, God, I am so sorry for my unbelief. The fact that I've lived a sinful life, I've rejected your son, Jesus Christ, I've actually rejected you. And God, I'm sorry for that. I now receive you as my Savior, Jesus Christ. I understand you died for my sins, that you love me, and I want you to come into my life. I'm tired of this life, and I want you to save me from my sins. Now, it's not a matter of the exact words. It's the heart from which those words came. And if God sees that you're sincerely repentant, you're sorry for the way you've been living, and you're ready to live a new life in Jesus Christ, he'll save you right on the spot. And this is how he begins the new work, by saving our soul, forgiving our sins, adopting us into the family of God, where he begins a work of grace in your life every day. And what's he doing? He makes us a part of the family of God, and then he begins developing the qualities that are desirable in conforming you into the image and likeness of Jesus Christ. In Jeremiah, the Bible tells us that God is like a potter. And he's sitting at the wheel, and he takes an old lump of clay, and he throws it on that wheel, and he begins that wheel going, and he puts that pedal down, and that wheel begins to spin, and the potter's hands take that old piece of clay, and he begins to shape it, and he begins to mold it, and he feels something in there that shouldn't be there, a foreign substance. What's he do? Does he leave it there? No, he pulls it out, and that's what he's trying to do in your life and my life. Pull these things out of our lives that make us flawed. They're vices. They're things that shouldn't be there. They're bad attitudes. They're sinful habits that we have. And the master potter spins us, and he's shaping us into this wonderful, beautiful object that he's going to use in his service. And he continues to spin us and spin us, and we're still spinning. He's still working on us. But he is going to finish the job, because God is God, and he made us, and he has a plan for our lives. And I have assurance of that. that if you are in the hands of Almighty God, He is going to fulfill His plan for your life. Our problem is we fight Him. We say, oh God, that hurt. Quit that. God says, I'm not going to quit it. Oh Lord, don't take that out of my life. I want that. I like that old clunker and that old piece of flawed material. Can you leave that one in? No. God says, I'm going to continue to work and clean up your life so that I can make a beautiful vessel out of your life that's meet for the master's service. And that's what He's doing. Reminds me of that story of the man who was sitting on the front porch on a summer day, and over in the corner of the porch, he saw that caterpillar that had made a cocoon. And while he sat there, he looked at the cocoon, and he noticed this cracking and a little butterfly wing starting to peek out of it, and it's starting to open up, and it's moving in its transition. And he watches and he watches it, and it's like the butterfly was struggling so to get out of this cocoon, and he felt sorry for the butterfly, and so he helps it. He tears the cocoon apart and lets the butterfly out, gives it a hand, only to find that the butterfly just laid there. And it tried to spread its wing. It couldn't do anything. It flopped around and everything, and it didn't do anything. And the more he helped it, the worse it became. One day he was talking to a friend of his that knew something about those things. He said, I don't understand it. The butterfly didn't fly away like I thought it would. He says, and you did what? He said, you helped it? He said, yeah, I made the hole bigger so it could get out quicker. He says, that was your mistake. You did what God wanted to do. You see, he says, that butterfly needed that affliction. It needed the struggle. In order, as it fought to get out of that, it scraped the skins and the former self off of itself so that it could transform itself into a butterfly. You didn't allow that to happen. And that butterfly will never be a butterfly now. Never fly, never enjoy what God had made it for, because you thought you helped it. You see, God's at work. If we just let God do His work in our lives, and if we would just obey God, follow God, do the things God asks us to do, we will develop and we will enjoy that abundant life. God has wonderful things planned for us. Our problem is we try to help God. God says, I'm sorry, I don't need your help. I want to say to you that there is an assurance that we have in God, in God's promises and His word, that we are victorious in Christ Jesus. Somebody said adversity is the tool that God often uses to strengthen our faith. And that's so true. I love the verses like 1 Corinthians 15:57. But thanks be to God which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Who gives us the victory? Me? No. Thanks be unto God which giveth us the victory through His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. For whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world. And this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. We like assurance. We want to believe that our marriage is fine. We want to believe our job is secure. We want to believe our health is good. We want to believe our children are safe. We love assurances where people can give us assurance. There's no problem. Your job's fine. Your income's fine. Your health is fine. Nothing wrong with your marriage. And on and on. And this, what assurance brings you comfort. It brings you peace. Everything's okay. And this is exactly what God does in our life. The peace that we are to enjoy in life comes from God's assurance that He's working on us and He's going to bring it to pass and give us a victorious Christian life. Secondly, He encourages Joshua. He says, Joshua, you're going to win the battle. Go ahead and fight the battle. The battle's mine. And Joshua says, okay, men, let's do this. So it brings me to the second point. God gave them the miracle they needed. First, He gives them the assurance that was required. They needed to hear from God. God, is life going to be okay? Are we going to be victorious? Yes, God says that it's okay. And child of God, I want to assure you, God, you are an overcomer in Christ Jesus. I can do all things through Christ which strengtheneth me. So accept the assurance. God's made a promise to you. Now, it's not without effort. You have to put out some effort. Now, God's going to do one of the greatest miracles ever recorded in the Bible. And yet, he didn't fight the battle for Joshua. Joshua had to fight some battle himself. But the point is that God gave them a miracle that they needed at that moment for that effort. Joshua chapter 10, verse 11. And it came to pass as they fled before Israel, that's these five kings and their armies, and were in going down to Beth Horam, that the Lord cast down great stones from heaven upon them unto Azekah, and they died. There were more which died with hailstones than they whom the children of Israel slew with the sword. Now let me pause there. That's a tremendous miracle, but you never hear about that. Nobody talks about that. God brought hailstones on the foreign army, killed more of them through hail than Joshua's army even did. That's a miracle. But let's go on, verse 12. Then spake Joshua to the Lord in the day when the Lord delivered up the Amorites before the children of Israel. And he said in the sight of Israel, here's Joshua, and he's looking out there, and he's seeing the battle. He sees what's going on. The enemy's fleeing. The hailstones are killing them. And there's tens of thousands of them. You have to understand that. And Joshua says, we're running out of time. So he cries out in the sight of Israel, Sun, stand thou still upon Gibeon, and thou moon in the valley of Ajalon. And the sun stood still, and the moon stayed until the people had avenged themselves upon their enemies. Is not this written in the book of Jasher? So the sun stood still in the midst of heaven and hasted not to go down about a whole day. And there was no day like that before it or after it, that the Lord hearkened unto the voice of a man, for the Lord fought for Israel. Incredible miracle. Joshua's into this thing. God has already promised him the victory, and he's going to complete the job at hand. But he saw that he's getting, daylight's running out. These people are fleeing. If I'm going to accomplish it, I need more daylight. And so he just speaks to the sun, speaks to the moon, stand still, give me some more time. And God gives him another day. Now you can imagine the scientists have taken this thing to task. You know, oh, this is just baloney. There's just no way, and you can hear them. Good grief. Everybody fall off the planet. You can't just stop the sun. You can't stop the earth. You can't stop its rotation. You can't stop what it's doing. You just can't do it. Well, let me assure you, God, you can't figure out God, number one. If God can just speak, as a matter of fact, he can take a handful of dust, create a man out of, blow in it, and make it a living soul. If God can do that, he can do anything he wants to do. Matter of fact, we're all come from that handful of dust that God put together one day and created an Adam and called him his name Adam and breathed into him the breath of life. God spoke the worlds into existence. Well, the scientists, you know how they are. They have to see it. They have to understand it. They have to reason it out, or they don't believe it. If they cannot visually see how it happens, then to them it does not exist. They say that the sun doesn't even, it's not the sun that's moving anyway. It's the earth is rotating and revolving. And And that is true. But it's interesting, Joshua here is simply using the language that we all use. The weathermen today, if you'll watch the Weather Channel, these guys have been to school, these gals, they study, and yet they still tell you when the sun will rise tomorrow and when it will set tomorrow. I looked at my cell phone last night on the weather station, and it says sunrise, such and such time. Sunset at such and such a time. And yet your scientists will today say, it's not the sun setting. It's not the moon rising. It's terminology that we understand. And that's exactly what Joshua was simply saying. The important thing here is not how God did it. The important thing is that he did do it. God simply allowed him to have more daylight. However he did this, and scientists are never going to figure it out. However, some of the skeptics said you'd think there'd be some mention, if something like this actually happened, there would be some writings in the annals of history about it. Well, the fact is there are. You just haven't heard about it. It's just like the flood. Well, if there was a worldwide flood, there would be writings in the annals of history. There are. There's all kinds of writings in these foreign countries over the years about a worldwide flood. They just don't bring those to the forefront. They don't want to tell you about that. But they all talk about it. They're all taken from the flood account in the Bible. Most every ancient culture that you study has a record of an extra long day. Just like most of them have a record of a worldwide flood. Herodotus, a Greek historian, wrote of an account of an extra long day left to us by the Egyptians. Others cite records of the Aztecs in Mexico reporting the sun standing still. Records of the Chinese during the reign of Emperor Yeo, who lived in Joshua's day, reported the strange occurrence of an extra long day that men were afraid that the world would even be burned because it is so astounding. You don't hear about that, though. In the late 1970s, the early 1980s, two stories appeared in print about a computer finding a missing day. You probably have read about that. NASA has disavowed this, of course. They don't want to bring that out. But I'm saying to you that there are accounts of a missing day, a long day. And the fact is, God recorded this in the Bible. This isn't the only place that it's recorded in the Bible. Habakkuk 3:11, you that make notes in your Bible. Habakkuk 3:11 says this, the sun and the moon stood still in their habitation. Now this was hundreds and hundreds of years after this prophet Habakkuk wrote about this. He believed it. God inspired him to write about it. And just as God worked a miracle for Joshua, he's very able to work a miracle for you. That's the point of this as well. God is a miracle-working God. And they poo-hoo this miracle, and yet the Bible is full of miracles. The burning bush, the 10 plagues of Egypt, crossing the Red Sea where the waters just begin to part on both sides. Moses and the Israelites go across on dry ground. The stopping of the Jordan River where the Israelites go into the promised land. The water stopped. The water allowed them dry entrance over to the promised land. And then the water starts back up again. A miracle of God. Manna from heaven for 40 years to feed the Israelites. There's no water, and so Moses strikes the rock and water pours out like an ocean of water. It's a miracle out of a rock. Elijah calls fire down from heaven. And a great fish swallows Jonah. We've all heard that one. Oh, it's impossible. Well, what about the other miracles? Daniel survives a night in the lion's den. I mean, they starve these lions, waiting to throw somebody in there, and they throw Daniel in the lion's den, and they start purring. Daniel just kind of fluffs up the mane of the lion and lays. Oh, that's nice. It's like one of those sleep pillows. Oh, man, this is nice. I think I'll just make a pillow out of this lion. And sleeps there all night. They pull Daniel out and they throw the people in that put him in there. And the Bible says that the lions ate them before they even hit the ground. How's that possible? God will work miracles. He still works miracles today. The three Hebrew children thrown into the fiery furnace. Don't you love that story? The king looks in there and says, ha, boy, it's good to get rid of them. That's not what he said. He says, something's wrong. Something's wrong with my eyes. I thought we threw three people in there. I see four of them walking around, and one like unto the Son of God. Jesus was in there with them. The Bible says that the king didn't know what to do. He pulls them out and it says that their garments didn't even have the smell of smoke on them. How's that possible? God. I'm saying to you, we serve the true and living God, and when he makes a promise, he keeps his promise. You can have that assurance. Luke 18:27, these things which are impossible with men are possible with God. Luke 1:37, with God nothing shall be impossible. It's interesting that God killed more enemy soldiers with the hail than they killed by the Israelite soldiers. When I look at God doing miracles, and we hear a lot about miracles today, everybody wants to see a miracle. But when you start to look at the Bible, why did God do miracles? He didn't just do it for show. Jesus did miracles and healed people. Everybody thinks he was there to heal people. No, he wasn't. If Jesus came to heal people, he would have healed everybody. He has that power. He can do anything he wants to do. I mean, there wouldn't have been anybody lame left in Israel. There would have been no lepers left. There would have been no blind people left. I mean, everywhere he went, if he was here to heal people, he could have healed everybody. But that wasn't why he was there. Matter of fact, he didn't even come to heal people. He came to save people. The healing simply attested to the fact that he was the Messiah, the Son of God. And they knew that they could believe what he said because they could see the power of God in his life. It vindicated and verified his message and who he was. And when you look back in the Old Testament and understand this, if you want a miracle in your life, when did God do them? He did them to enable a person to complete a task or to take on a task that God had given them. In other words, it was in his service. Joshua needs a miracle. Why? Because he's doing the work of God. Elijah needs a miracle. Why? Because he's doing the work of God. You start looking at where God did the miracles. Moses, why do you need a miracle? Because I'm doing the work of God. You want God a miracle in your life? Do something for God. Do something for God. God will show himself strong on your behalf if you are actually trying to accomplish something for God. I'm saying to you, go out on a limb for God. Go out there where you could fall on your face. Say, I don't know, God, this is pretty dangerous out here. God says, that's where I do miracles. You want to see my handy work? Get out there where you need me. I mean, you're now dependent upon me pulling you out of the fire. God says, that's where my miracles are. I'm not just going to go do a miracle just because you want a miracle. Because you want to see God do something super in your life, and you go out and tell everybody God did something super in my life. No, no. Someday when you're doing something for God, and you're overwhelmed, and you don't even know how it's going to get done, God will come through and do something marvelous for you. You'll say, wow, God, thank you. He always does miracles to help you to complete a task or enable you to take on a task. Gideon, I mean, you just go through the Bible. Gideon says, God, I need a miracle from you here. I'm going to put this little fleece out here. It's going to be a nice dry night. I want this thing to be wet in the morning. It was. He says, let's change this around. I want it to be dry in the morning. It was. Why would he do that? Because he said, Gideon, I got a job for you. And I want you to know that when you go do this job, it's a dangerous job. I'll be with you. I'll take care of you. And he did. And Gideon was successful. And so God doesn't just waste miracles. He does them so that we can complete some task or take on a task that he's assigned us to. Sometimes he'll do it just for his glory. The man who was born blind, and all of a sudden he had his sight. Why the miracle? So that God could get the glory and the guy could just give glory to God. You see, God is at work in our lives. And sometimes he'll do it in our witnessing. I always look at it as a miracle every time God gives me an opportunity to witness to somebody for Jesus Christ and they accept him as their personal Savior. I said, thank you, Lord, for that miracle. That's a miracle of grace. It wasn't me, it was you, God. You just turned that soul around. And they gave their life to Jesus Christ. You want to do something? You want to see a miracle? Go out and do something for God. The Bible says, finally, my brother, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Aren't you glad for the Holy Spirit that comes into our lives? And why? So it's God living in us through the presence of the Holy Spirit to empower us for this victorious life that he wants us to have. And he will guide us and direct us, work the miracles as needed. But he's there to help us be successful in our venture in life. Number three and lastly, God gave them the support necessary in verse 42. Joshua chapter 10, verse 42. And all these kings in their land did Joshua take at one time, because the Lord God of Israel fought for Israel. Andrew Murray one time wrote, he said this, God is willing to assume full responsibility for the life that is totally yielded to him. I'll say that again. Andrew Murray said this, God is willing to assume full responsibility for the life that is totally yielded to him. Now, God didn't do all the fighting. He did the hailstones. He gave them sufficient light to accomplish the task. Israel had to do the task. He learned that these kings, when they saw that their armies were defeated, they hid themselves in a cave, if you read through chapter 10. And Joshua learned about that. So he goes and he finds out where these kings, the top people, were hiding, and he rolled a stone over the cave so that they would be there. Joshua goes ahead, uses the daylight that he has, that God's given him, sufficient daylight, and goes ahead and finishes the task. And then he comes back to deal with the kings. Rolls the stone away, there they are. And he puts them to death, basically. I liken those kings to besetting sins. They're the leaders. They're the stronghold. But they have to die too. The Bible tells us that we are, well, let me give you the verse, if I might. We are to get rid of the besetting sins that doth so easily beset us. There are sins in our lives and influences in our lives that are strong, they're powerful. And unfortunately, it's those things that we say, well, I'll just leave that one there. It's so strong and it's so powerful. You know, the Bible speaks of some strong influences. It talks about Satan, of course. It talks about the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, of course, the pride of life. And you can put the fifth one in there, whatever you want. Maybe it's just, for most of the world, it's rebellion against God and His Son, Jesus Christ. Reasons that they'll never give their life to Christ. Strong, powerful leaders that keep them under Satan's control. Joshua says, come on, we got some unfinished business. We're going to take care of those two. We're going to get rid of the kings as well. And the Bible says that he went back after he had taken care of fighting the armies and winning, went back and took the kings out. And he told the children of Israel and the princes of Israel, put them down. And they put their necks on the ground and they put their foot on their necks, showing that we have conquered them. They are now under our dominion. Now, the Bible says sin, once you become a Christian, sin is no longer to have dominion in your life. You know that? We are to conquer that. They're an enemy. They fight us. They make us less than what God wants us to be. We're unusable to God as long as we are harboring these sins, these strong sins in our lives. Now, Joshua killed all this army, but he says, I still have five left, and I got to do something with them. And he brought them and showed them that he had dominion over them. Sin's not going to have dominion over me. Sir, you're not going to any longer have dominion over us. And the Bible says he took them out and hung them. Hung all five kings. He got victory over them. He did exactly what God told him to do. We fight against sin. We fight against self. We fight against Satan every day, and it's not an easy task. The enemy is out there. The Bible tells us that, well, in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. That's our enemy. He seeks to bring us low so we can no longer serve God and be what God wants us to be. Don't allow that to happen in your life. Be strong in the Lord. There's an old English proverb that says, a smooth sea never made a skilled mariner. Isaiah 41:10, fear thou not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee. Yea, I will help thee. Yea, I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness. Isaiah 41:10. Talk about a promise. He says, don't fear. Don't fear the enemy. You say, I got all these temptations in life and all these evil influences in life, and it seems like I can't get out from under them. God is saying, don't you fear. I am with thee. I am thy God. I will strengthen thee. I will help thee. I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness. God is there for that very purpose, to help us be victorious. An artist was teaching some students how to paint. It was a beautiful sunset that they were painting. He took them out on a hillside, and they watched the sunset. All the while, all these people were trying to paint this setting sun. The artist moved from canvas to canvas. He stopped by a young man who was having trouble. And he looked at the young man's painting. He could see why. He says, what's your problem, young man? He says, I'm having trouble getting the barn right. The teacher exclaimed by pointing to the horizon, young man, look, the sun is setting. And while the sun's setting, and that's what you're to be painting, you're putting shingles on a barn. And the lesson is this: we get focused on the wrong thing in life. We have an enemy. We are to fight the good fight of faith each and every day, because I guarantee you the enemy's coming after you and coming after me, trying to stop us. The sun's soon going to set on your life, and it's going to set on my life as well. And someone once said, only what's done for Christ will last. Let's live victoriously for Christ Jesus. Stand with me, please.
Welcome to the family. You can feel at home here. There's a lot of love that goes beyond these years. There's nothing like the fellowship of those who love the Lord. So welcome to the family. There's always room for more. When I count my blessings, it's easy to see. My brothers and sisters, that mean so much to me. Kept me in their prayers, and the countless ways they've always shown me that they care. And I know they'll still walk with me no matter what's ahead. Yeah, so much more than just their words, their lives have always said. Welcome to the family, you can feel at home. There's nothing like the fellowship of those who love the Lord. So welcome to the family. Oh, welcome to the family. You can feel at home here. There's a lot of love that goes beyond these years. There's nothing like the fellowship of those who love the Lord. So welcome to the family. Oh, welcome to the family. Welcome to the family. There's always room for more.
Nothing but a poor lost soul, far from God and on the road to hell.
But the Savior met me with a deter sign, and he saved my soul with his power divine.
That's when I'm happy to say, I started on the glory land way.
It may be on the mountain, in the valley, where the narrow way might be, or a bridge over troubled stormy waters, where my journey might carry me. But I can't turn aside to an easy road, if I could have known and ever would stay.
I've been walking with you, climbing each mountain, walking each valley. books from cover to cover.
Teach, preacher, teach it, and then preach it again from one end to the other. Don't water it down, don't modern it up. Let it say what it has to say.
Six books from God.